we have the last speaker today, John Morgan from the university, talking about quality courses.
Thank you. Well, it's a great pleasure and honor to be here. When Phuong first asked me to talk, I had a conversation much like the one Charlie reported yesterday. I said, well, Phuong, anything I would talk about has nothing to do with the conference. And Phuong said, that's all right, talk anyway. He didn't make the mistake that he made with Charlie of saying, just make sure you put some PDE in. Phuong knows me. So I was a colleague of Mathematakis for 33 years. I watched him in his department, his gentle, quiet, thoughtful way. It was just enormous respect for him personally. I was really amazed when he became chairman of the department, how he managed to interact with this Byzantine administrative system we have here at Columbia, which is especially Byzantine. My respect for him grew as I watched him deal with all of this in his quiet Japanese way. The one time I had serious mathematical interactions with him was when Bob Friedman and I were studying gauge theory, and we were beginning to confront some of these problems that you heard about, the analogs and symplectic geometry from Kenji and Dusa. What do you do when the moduli spaces aren't smooth? So we went to Masataki and asked him to explain to us his theory. And over a couple of days and two or three sessions, he gave us beautiful presentations of how it all works. So, very fond memories of all of that. All right, well, in the spirit of this talk, what I'm going to talk about goes back 45 years to when I first learned about the Goreski-McPherson intersection homology. I was at IHES at the time. And I immediately understood how to use what they had done and extend it from rational coefficients, the even strata. They were interested in algebraic variety, complex algebraic variety, so it's fine for their purposes. Anyway, extended to spaces with all strata and integer coefficients. And in doing that, I would be able to construct a Bordism theory, I'll tell you a little bit about, which would be the appropriate theory of cycles for surgery theory. This is back in the days when surgery theory was what I was studying. And these would also be the cycles for real K theory, at least at odd primes. Well, I never wrote that up. About the same time, and for very similar reasons, I believe, Jeff Cheever completely independently did a version of this theory using differential forms and the Hodge-Star operator, and L2 forms and the Hodge-Star operator. One reason I didn't write it up was the original Goreski-McPherson argument involved triangulations and simplices, and it was a little cumbersome, and I just didn't really want to deal with that. Eventually, Balanson, Bernstein, and Delinea redid this theory from the point of view of sheaf theory, much cleaner, much better, and that's, in fact, more or less what I will present to you today. This work also overlaps with work that a student of Sylvain Capel's did 10 to 15 years ago, where again, I think he did the rational version as I understand it, but from a point of view very similar to what I'm going to describe today. So, since I'm going to talk about a Bordism theory of fairly exotic objects, let me start just to remind you of what ordinary Bordism theory is. So we have our objects are simply closed manifolds, closed, and I'm going to say oriented manifolds. Dimensions, and we put an equivalence relation on them. We say that M is equivalent to M prime if there is a compact manifold of one dimension higher, whose boundary is M minus M prime. the strength of the group and every dimension in. I've called the boardism or co-boardism groups. You can multiply them and make a ring. Well, the addition is simply disjoint union, or if you prefer, connected sum. The multiplication is product of manifolds. You get a nice ring, usually denoting the boardism or co-boardism. Well, what I'm going to do today is give you a different boardism theory, not based on smooth manifolds, but based on certain kinds of stratified spaces. But the basic picture will be the same. We'll define closed objects. They will satisfy some kind of Frank Ray duality. We'll have compact objects with boundaries. They'll satisfy a Lefschetz duality. And together, they'll make a boardism theory that's much smaller in the sense that the coefficients of the boardism theory are much smaller. And in fact, what those boardism groups are exactly the groups that you would get if you replaced closed oriented manifolds by chain complexes with a chain isomorphism satisfying Poincaré ray duality, capping with the fundamental cycle. And you replace compact manifolds with boundary with long exact sequences of chain complex that has as its boundary term the chain complex of the closed manifold. So just take what you get when you talk about chains, integral coefficients for compact manifolds. Well, you get a chain complex C and you get a cap product with a fundamental cycle, a fundamental chain of degree n, and that maps you to dual chain complex. So, right here, I'm going to say something that, you know, when we learn algebraic topology, the chains are in positive dimension and the cochains are in positive dimension. But that's really not the right way to think about it. If you have homomorphisms between chain complexes of A to B, this itself is a chain complex, and the things of degree D or the things of degree zero are the things that preserve degree, things of degree one are the things that raise degree by one, things of degree minus one lower degree by one. Well, this is in degree zero. So if the degree here is star, the degree here has to be minus star. So I'm taking a point of view of sheaf theory. So for me, cochains, sections of sheaves, are always going to be indexed in positive degree, which means that my homology groups are going to be indexed in negative degree, and they're just the negatives of the one you're used to using. Now, basically, I'm a geometer. And if you ask me how I would like to do it, I would like to put the cycles, the geometric objects, in positive degree. They have a dimension, after all. And that would force the cochains of the sheaves into negative degree. But you have to choose. And today, I'm going to take this choice. Anyway, so this is what Poincaré duality is. As long as this is a free chain complex or a free chain complex, you can get away with just taking the homomorphisms to Z. But if you have more exotic chain complexes, like abelian groups or torsion in them, this is not an appropriate notion of dual. And also, even for this a free chain complex, when you write it this way, you don't see how to compute the relationship between the homology and the cohomology, the so-called universal coefficient theorem. So the right thing to do, actually, is to replace this by something that's quasi-isomorphic to it. So another chain complex, which is bigraded. Well, it graded it in the way I told you. Here, I is a very simple chain complex. And it has two basic properties that mean this is the right thing to do. One is there's a map from the chain complex of Z in degree zero to this chain complex, just include Z into Q. And that induces an isomorphism on homology. As you can see, this is a short exact sequence. So H1 of this complex is zero because this map is surjective, and H0 is Z. So this complex and this one in the world we're working in are equivalent objects. This one is much better in that these groups are divisible. And technically, these means these are injective groups. So they have the sort of properties that make homological algebra work much better. So you really want to think of the dual as lying here. For simple chain complexes, you can just use a free chain complex. You can just use this one. But when you view it this way, you see it's really a bicomplex. There are two gratings. So you have a square of terms, and you can filter one way or another. You filter vertically and take homology. You get the homology of C mapping into I. And so what you learn by that little filtration argument is you get a short exact sequence for the homology of this dual object. It maps over to the homomorphisms from the homology of C to the integers. And over here, you have the term that's called X1, but what it is simply hom of the, hom of the homology 1 degree higher into Q mod Z over the hom. 1 degree higher into Q. So the co-kernel of this map. If these groups are finitely generated, these homology groups are finitely generated, then this is simply the homomorphisms from the torsion of H star plus one of M. Well, this is the short exact sequence you learn in first year algebraic topology, universal coefficient theorem. I go through this in detail because we're going to see other versions of sort of construction later. So that was completely general about the dual chain complex. Now suppose we have a duality in the chain complex, as we do for closed manifolds. That would tell us that the homology of the chain complex, well, is isomorphic to the homology of the dual chain complex. So from this exact sequence, we get pairings. These are the pairings you're used to. One pairing is H star of C star, insert H in minus star of C star into the integers. That comes from having a map of the free part of the homology into the homomorphism from the homology to Z. And the other is the torsion of H star plus one of C star, tensor the torsion H n minus star of C star into Q mod Z. So unraveling what it means to have an isomorphism between the homology of C star and this group, you see these two pairings. Well, these are, of course, well-known pairings. Since the image here is the integers, we can divide out by the torsion. And let me denote the homology mod torsion by, say, F star of C. So F star of C n minus star of C star into the integers. This is the cohomological version of the intersection pairing. If you have a cycle of dimension K and a cycle of, well, if you have a cohomology class of dimension K, it has a dual cycle in dimension n minus K. these would have dual cycles of dimension K. So we take those two cycles, we put them in general position inside the manifold. We get these transversal points of intersection. We add up the signs, and this is the pairing. And of course, it's a perfect pairing. Makes each group the adjoint of the other. This is the torsion pairing, or the Lincoln pairing. In terms of cycles, you have cycle A, another cycle B, their dimension K is N minus K minus one. By Poincaré duality, notice the sum of these dimensions, two dimensions, is N plus one. So the sum of these dimensions, two dimensions, would be N minus one. These are torsion cycles, disjoint. So some multiple of A is the boundary of a chain C. And then I can take C dot B and take one over N dot C. That turns out to be a well-defined pairing. So Poincaré duality is this isomorphism homology here, which is completely captured by the intersection pairing, which is a perfect pairing, and the linking pairing, which is also a perfect pairing. Now these pairings have symmetry, which I'll just write that. The first one, Fk, tensor F n minus k to z, has a symmetry minus one to the k, n minus k under interchange. Equal sign we expect. And the torsion of hk plus one, tensor torsion of hn minus k into q mod z, has the same pairing, minus one to the k plus one and minus k. Now, as always, when you have things that are paired, there's not much information between two different things that are paired with each other, either free abelian groups or torsion subgroups. The interest where there's something more to be said is when a group is paired with itself. So if M is of dimension 2k, closed oriented manifold, then the self-dual pairing is Fk of M, Fk of M, integers, which is minus one to the k symmetric. If M is 4k, this is a symmetric pairing. If M is 4k plus two, this is a skew symmetric pairing. And again, it's perfect. So if you choose a basis, write a matrix, so the determinant of the matrix is plus or minus one in both cases. If M is 2k minus one, then the self-dual pairing is the torsion of hk of m, into the torsion of hk of m, q mod z, the linking pairing, and it's got symmetry minus one to the k. So it's a symmetric pairing in cases is a 4k minus one manifold, 4k plus three manifold, and it's a skew symmetric pairing when the manifold is dimension 4k plus one. And again, it's perfect. I won't go through as much detail, but you can imagine when you have a compact manifold with boundary, Wn plus one and Wn, you get a self-dual under Lefschetz duality, long exact sequence, which has the homology of M in the middle, the homology of W restricting, and then the homology one higher relative. These groups are dual to each other in exactly these ways, and this group is self-dual. And this sequence, both the free part and the torsion part, is self-adjoint. So the intersection pairing here between AX, A being this map, and Y, so AX and Y are elements here, is the same thing as the about under the duality between these two evaluation of X on the relationship. Well, so now you can ask in general, suppose you have a chain complex satisfies duality in degree n. When does it fit in a sequence like this? Does it always fit in a sequence like this? Don't worry about whether or not we have manifolds. Can we just find a chain complex, a dual chain complex, and dual maps? Well, the answer is no. It's probably everyone here knows very well. For n equals 4k, there is an obstruction to the existence. Left shift dual sequence with center, some dual chain complex, C star self dual. So this is purely at the level of chain complexes, though of course it would apply to manifolds as well. And what you need a Lagrangian subspace in order to be able to. To produce the Lefschetz sequence. So you need a subspace, L, I'll call it L bar and FK of M. It's self-annihilating. And with the induced pairing from L bar into an isomorphism. So half-dimensional self-annihilating subspace. Right. The complete analog of a Lagrangian submanifold in self-direct context. And we know when such a self-annihilating subspace exists. It exists. L bar exists. Well, if we're doing 4K, if n is congruent to 2 mod 4, so I should have done 4K, 2K, if n is congruent to 2 mod 4, this pairing is skew symmetric, perfect. So it's always a direct sum of 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, minus 1, 0 pairing. So there's a Lagrangian subspace. And if the signature of the manifold for, of the pairing is 0 for n congruent to 0 mod 4. Because if you have a self-annihilating subspace of half the dimension, then you can write the pairing in the symmetric case like that. And it's easy to see it as signature zero. So signature is obvious, necessary, invariant. It's not too hard to prove it's sufficient as well. So that's for the intersection pairings. What about for the torsion pairings? For the torsion pairings, in the case of odd manifolds, chain complexes satisfying duality in odd dimensions, for the torsion pairings in 4K plus 3 always exists. In the case of a symmetric linking pairing, this is basically the fact that any symmetric linking pairing comes from a symmetric matrix. From A to A star with torsion as the quotient, and the linking pairing here being induced from the rational intersection pairing here. So this is an injection determinant is positive, or determinant is non-zero bigger than one. In fact, the determinant is the order of the torsion group. So every torsion module can be produced out of a symmetric interval pairing. So these are free abelian groups. But it's not true in dimension 4k plus 1. It is an invariant. It's a Z2 invariant. And for reasons I no longer remember on the Durand variant. So it has nothing to do with differential forms. And he was the first one to discuss it. So we're now talking about odd pairings. We want to know whether or not there's a subgroup in this torsion group of square root of the order of the square root of the order of the group, which is self-annihilated. So Lincoln pairing vanishes on it. Well, here's one way to think about it. Consider the map. So first of all, L of XX in Q mod Z is always in 0, 1 half, because it's skew symmetric. Skew symmetric here means it plus itself is 0 in Q mod Z. But it doesn't have to be 0. Well, this is a homomorphism. X to L of XX is a homomorphism from your torsion group Z mod 2, which sits in Q mod Z. And by the fact that the pairing is perfect, that means that there's a characteristic vector V unique in the torsion group, such that L of XV is equal L of XX for all X. And the Durand invariant is by definition L of V. That turns out well. That turns out to be the obstruction to a Lagrangian subspace. There's another more naive way to say it. Just decompose the torsion group into a Dirac sum of cyclic factors and count the number of Z mod 2s. If it's odd, the Durand invariant is non-trivial. If it's even, the Durand invariant is zero. That turns out to be another way to get it. Anyway, this is the obstruction. So if we were to build a Bordism theory on these chain complexes, these duality chain complexes, it would have groups Z, Z2, 0, 0, 4 periodic. This would be the signature. This would be the Durand invariant. There are no problem, no invariants in dimension 2 and 3. So I want to build a geometric theory where these are the Bordism coefficients. Not only abstractly are the groups the same, these objects, our closed object, Xn, is going to have associated with it a complex of sheaves. And the cohomology, and the hypercohomology of X coefficients in this complex, is going to satisfy. There is going to be a duality isomorphism between this sheaf and the dual sheaf. And then when you apply derived functors and take homology, you get exactly the statements of Poincaré duality. These groups are all finitely generated from compact manifolds. So these are the closed objects. And if you have Wn plus 1 boundary of W compact, you get, again, there's a sheaf, complex of sheaves, whose restriction to the boundary of W is quasi-isomorphic to the thing on the boundary. And it satisfies Lefschetz duality, which maybe the easiest way to think about it is to remove the boundary, have an open manifold with a cylindrical end, and the pairing goes between the cohomology of the sheaf and the compactly supported cohomology of the sheaf. Cohomology of the sheaf is cohomology of W, compactly supported cohomology is the relative cohomology. Their dual fits into that sequence. So what kind of objects, what are geometric objects? They're stratified spaces. Let me just say a few words about that. So the first thing you have when you have a stratified space is you have a decomposition of the space X into Xn, X naught, X1, X2. I'm not going to allow any strata of dimension n minus one. So the next stratum down from the top is going to be codimension two at least. So Xi is a i-dimensional manifold and has finitely many components, and its components are the I strata of stratification. These are locally closed subspaces. And the closure of any one of them is the union of Xi and strata. That's first thing. We need a little bit more information than this. Usually in differential topology anyway, this Whitney conditions A and B that you could put on, where you assume these guys are smooth manifolds and you have various convergence, say smooth, each one of the whole space X sits in an ambient smooth manifold. So these are smooth submanifolds, and there's some convergence conditions on tangent spaces and secant lines, which I won't write down. A differential topological assumption, which is quite useful. Tom and Mather abstracted that out and gave a notion of control data on a stratified space, which tells you at least locally what the links of any one of the strata look like. I don't need any of that sophisticated smooth topology. All I need is that we have the following picture around some i-dimensional stratum. So it'll be an inductive definition. We'll have the link of the i-dimensional stratum, and they'll call it N. This is the link. It is a stratified space. Of dimension n minus the dimension of sigma minus one, and locally along the stratum we have an open set u in sigma I, well, I don't want to call it u, of an open set v in sigma I, and have v cross the cone on the link, where the stratification of the link cone on the link has its induced stratification already. The cone on the link is stratified by simply taking the cone on all the strata, open cone plus the cone point. Then I take the product of V with this, becomes a stratified space using this stratification across the manifold. Okay. So this is a locally trivial stratification along each strata. And all these differential conditions I was talking about before, the Whitney conditions or the Tom Mather, ensures this actually in a differentiable context. So those are our stratified spaces. The simplest possible stratified space with two strata would be some manifold M with boundary N and the cone on N. So this would be X, this is the cone on N, M glued together along this boundary. The stratification, Xn is everything except the cone point, and X0 is the cone point. So I want to talk about how you make a duality for this sort of object. Once I know how to do that, it's easy to extend the point so it becomes a whole submanifold. So I have a two stratum space. And then you just repeat the argument by induction down through the strata. Here's the way we're going to do it. So we have the homology of N. So this side satisfies Lefschetz duality. In order to get the whole thing to satisfy Lefschetz duality, the whole thing to satisfy Poincaré duality, I need this side to satisfy Lefschetz duality, where this is the, where here I have to use the homology of N, the honest homology. So I need some exotic homology that I can apply to the cone on N so that with this exotic homology and the relative version, becomes the Lefschetz sequence. Well, a priori, there are many ways you could think about doing this. There's one way that actually is natural and works well with all these constructions and goes back to building a beautiful and simple idea. So in this case, we have a chain complex, or actually just think about the homology groups. So we have the homology groups, and let me do the case first when N is dimension 2K. And in order for me to perform this construction, as I've already told you, I need to know that the signature of N is zero. That's no condition if this is 4K plus 2 manifold, but it is a condition, though it's automatically satisfied since N bounds N. So I need a Lagrangian subspace inside the free part of the middle dimensional homology. I have to choose one. So this construction will be an inductive construction. At each stage, I'm working down into the stratum. And at any stage, I might not be able to continue the construction. In other words, not every stratified space is going to end up being a duality space. For this stratified space to be a duality space, well, I need the signature of N to be zero, which is automatic. But if I had another submanifold here, I'd be in a context where I didn't know that. Anyway, so each stage will hit a problem. And if we can choose a Lagrangian submanifold, we have to make that choice. That choice will be built into the sheaf that we're carrying along, the duality sheaf. Different choices will give different notions of duality. Some you might be able to continue all the way down, others might hit a problem. Sort of like obstruction theory, you can only see one step at a time. You make a choice. Some choices may be good, others may be bad. There may be no way to make a choice. Anyway, we need a Lagrangian subspace, so I choose one. And now I truncate less than or equal to L bar of the, L of the homology of N. Let me explain that to you. So first of all, L bar is a Lagrangian subspace in the free part. L is simply the inverse image of this Lagrangian subspace in the entire cohomology in degree K. So it's abstractly and non-canonically isomorphic to L bar plus all the torsion. So that's the subspace I'm talking about. I'm going to truncate, and this collection of groups, graded groups, well, it's the homology of N for star less than K. It's L for star equals K, and it's zero for star greater than K. So I take the bottom half of the cohomology, where half has to be interpreted with respect to this Lagrangian. If you think about this, I do have exactly half the homology because it's the free part that's self-paired and I've picked half of that. I have all the lower stuff, which is dual to all the upper stuff. And I have the torsion in degree K, which is paired in cohomology with the torsion in degree K minus one, plus one. All right, I have the torsion in degree K, but not the torsion in degree K plus one, and those are dually paired. So I also have half the torsion. All right, and by that remark, you see that this is a Lefschetz or exact sequence. I take these groups into the homology N, into the homology N modulus truncation. Well, this becomes a self-dual long exact sequence. This, in the natural way, is dual to that. These are dual parts of the homology. And these maps are dual. Maybe I won't write it down, but what you do in the odd degree case is L will be the Lagrangian submanifold in HK, in the torsion of HK, and you again do this truncation on that Lagrangian. So everything below plus that torsion in HK. All right. So what I'm trying to achieve is somehow to build chains or sheaves so that the homology of the cone on N turns out to be this lower half of the homology of N, the cohomology of N, and then the relative, that should be the relative cohomology. Well, this is not a canonical enough construction to, I don't have any change. I've just said what I want the groups to be. All right, now I have to introduce a term, a symbol that when I first saw it and for many years afterwards terrified me, but I finally got used to it. So let's take the constant sheaf on, let's call this, the open thing is Xn, so everything except the cone point. Let's take the constant sheaf on the top stratum, concentrated in degree n. Concentrated in degree zero. That's right. I want to push that sheaf forward from this open subset to all of X. So let the inclusion Xn into X bj. I'm going to push this sheaf forward, but of course I have to do it correctly for homology, so I have to take the right derived functors of pushing it forward. So what this says is take some resolution of Z in sheaves, now not in abelian groups, in sheaves over X so that they're sufficiently good. Injective or flabby, some sheaf that has lots and lots of sections. Take that injective resolution or whatever resolution you want to use, and then to any open set, you can restrict the resolution to that open set. You'll get a chain complex, and that chain complex of sections over that open set, that will calculate the integral homology of that open set. That's what this means. Well, that's, and now RJ star says, well, at any point away from the cone point, you just have something equivalent to the sheaf you started with. At the cone point, you have to take a neighborhood of the cone point and intersect it with this open set and take the homology of that. So on any reasonable neighborhood, you have a cofinal set of neighborhoods, which is just a cone on smaller versions of N. You get, so the cohomology hyperchromology of this sheet on any cone on n, so from 0 to t. Well, you write the space on the other side. So if I take any cone from 0 to t, say t less than 1, on n of this push forward sheaf, the complex of sheaves, I simply get the ordinary cohomology of the punctured neighborhood. Because the way you push a sheaf forward is for any open set, you take the intersection of that open set with the previous space where the thing came from, that is, we're just puncturing the open set, and take its cohomology. So in other words, this has the effect of simply opening this space up and removing the cone point. But it's now cohomology of a sheaf on all of X, not on the sheaf on all of X. It has a cohomology of the cone point right there. All right. Now we apply the truncation, not to the cohomology groups, the Lean's truncations, but rather to the restriction of this sheaf to the cone point. So the stalk of this complex of sheaves over the cone point, just by taking direct limits, is again the cohomology of this punctured neighborhood. So the stalk is pushed forward of the complex. Cone point is again, well, the homology. Homology sheaf is simply the homology. It's a complex of sheaves. It's homology over this point, the homology of the stalks at this point is simply the cohomology of N or the cohomology of these punctured neighborhoods. So I truncate. Well, I guess the restriction of this sheaf to that point. Okay. So take this stalk, this complex given by the stalks over the cone point. That's a complex of sheaves. This truncation operation that I was talking about, which I did for a group of a homology group, actually works for sheaves. So if you have a sheaf, say zeta naught, zeta one, zeta two, zeta n, and you have some subsheaf inside the homology sheaf in dimension k of zeta, so a subsheaf of the homology sheaf, then you can form the truncation at S of this complex. And what does it have? So it has the complex up to, but not including zeta k, in degree k, it has only cycles, that is things in the kernel of D, and cycles whose homology class is in S at every stalk. So this works just as well and for complexes and the effect of truncation. Truncation is an exact functor. So if you truncate a complex and then take the homology, you'll get the truncation of the homology. So that's my sheaf. I take my complex of sheaves. So I started with the constant sheaf over X naught. I replaced it by some injective complex of sheaves, quasi isomorphism. I took the push forward. So this is a sheaf on complex of sheaves on all of X. And I can map it to the quotient by this truncation operation. So push forward the stalk. So I push forward the stalk over the cone point, truncated. Where this means this is the quotient of the entire complex by the truncation. So this is nice. And what you're left with, you haven't changed the stalks of these sheaves or the homology stalks of these sheaves, except at the cone point. And what you've done, the kernel of this will exactly have the kernel of this projection to the quotient. So what you'll have here is a sheaf which agrees away from the cone point with the sheaf you started with, still satisfies duality out there, and has the restriction of the sheaf to the cone point is simply the truncation less than or equal to L of R star C. And so I've now produced this sheaf whose cohomology, well, it's the constant sheaf away from the cone point, so it calculates ordinary cohomology out there. And at the cone point, it calculates exactly half the cohomology of N. So this sheaf has the properties that I wanted, and you can now prove that it is a self-dual sheaf. I don't think I have time to talk about the proof of self-duality. All right, so what do we do now? First thing to do is replace the point by a submanifold. Sigma. So we're going to have a stratified space with two strata, the cone on some link here. And outside we have here, M. We need in the link, called the link N, we again need a Lagrangian subspace in in the original sheaf. Well, homology, sorry, in the cohomology of N. Depending on, it's got nature depends on whether N is even or odd as before. We do exactly the same construction, but we need this Lagrangian submanifold subspace to be invariant under monodromy. So it has to be invariant under monodromy. So this is this push forward sheaf that we're making. For L to determine a sub sheaf in cohomology, it has to be invariant under the monodromy action of the fundamental group of sigma on the phi group. So these things are locally trivial, so I do have a monodromy action. In that case, just as before, I can do the truncation on Rj star of sigma, restricted to now the submanifold. And you had Poincaré duality along sigma. This satisfies the Lefschetz duality. So this tube now has the Lefschetz duality you need to plug into the Lefschetz duality from the outside and get Poincaré duality. And then you just go by induction, one stratum at a time. I should say when you do more than one stratum, at the intermediate stages, you're working with non-compact manifolds. So here I only had two strata. My first stratum was open, but by the time I put in the second one, I had a compact manifold. When you work with these open things, this duality, as usual, goes between the homology of the sheaf and the compactly supported homology of the sheaf. By the time you get to compact objects, this is the same and you get the duality. But before you get to compactness, this is like the duality between compactly supported homology and cohomology on a non-compact manifold. Okay. All right. So those are my objects. They're these stratified spaces that have these self-dual complex of sheaves on them. X is compact and stratified. So the hypercohomology of X with coefficients in this complex satisfies microduality. So it has an index signature if the dimension is congruent to 0 mod 4, and it has a Durham invariant if the dimension is congruent to 1 mod 4. If those invariants vanish, or if you're in dimension 2 or 3, this stratified space bounds in the theory for a completely trivial reason. We have one of these XC, and it has a Lagrangian subspace in cohomology. Choose one such, and then the cone on this thing, using that choice of Lagrangian submanifold, you can extend the self-dual sheaf over the cone. So this thing, in fact, bounds the cone with the self-dual sheaf built out of this one and that Lagrangian subspace. So for completely trivial reasons, anything that satisfies that whose invariants are zero, in fact, bounds. On the other hand, because the signature and Durham invariant are invariants of Bordism of these objects, that proves that Poincaré duality Bordism. The coefficients are the signature, the Durham invariant, and zero. This is periodic. Except in dimension one. Because I don't have any stratified spaces that aren't manifolds in dimension one. So I don't have a Durham invariant in dimension one. It's not a problem. So these are exactly. These are the cycles for a surgery problem. Maybe nobody in the audience remembers what surgery theory is. You have a certain kind of map called the normal map between two manifolds, and you're trying to surgery the domain until the map becomes a homotopy equivalence. And there's a space of those as a classifying space whose homotopy groups are four periodic like this. These things are cycles in that if you have a surgery problem, X to Y, and you take any one of these Bordism elements and you map it into Y, you can pull this surgery problem back over the Bordism element and get an analogous surgery problem over the Bordism element. These have signatures, Durham invariants, and the pairing is exactly perfect by various product formulas. So you can tell what your surgery problem is by knowing the signature of all these Bordism elements, the signature you get from the surgery problems obtained by mapping these Bordism elements in and restricting the surgery problem to the Bordism element. And a similar statement is true for real K theory, at least away from two. Away from two, you see these groups are four periodic with a Z here and zero anywhere else. It's exactly the groups for real K theory. So these are the cycles that I wanted. To prove that these are the cycles for K theory, one has to meld what I've been talking about here through sheaf theory with Cheeger's approach using differential forms, L2 forms, and the hard star operator. But in fact, they're built out of the same ingredients, so there's not a problem like that. All right, thank you.
That we see as a resolution of the push forward of this sheet, right? So it's a huge statement. In fact, how do you compute?
Well, Well, to begin with, I know how to compute for the constant sheave. I mean, you're right, these sheaves, if you use a Godemall resolution, it is uncountably large. Nevertheless, because of Czech cohomology, we know the answer for the constant sheaf is the usual topological singular or Czech cohomology. So for these spaces, the singular cohomology. Now these sheaves along the strata are not so bad. They're local systems. In fact, I can, if you want, take them to be trivial local systems with finitely generated groups, which are just these Poincaré duality groups of the link. So you have pretty good control over what the local homology sheaves are. So it's not exactly the same as the integers, but it's not that much worse.
So you also the case that next is a complex algebra, but I think that n is always continental. So no kind of
right.
index, but you have of this two torsion type thing in abstractions.
Yeah, you have a problem with that.
So as I need example of this compressor algebra, but I do not have this structure.
Yeah, I mean it's easy to make complex varieties with torsion in their homology in their middle. I mean made examples, I think, you know, dividing out hypersurfaces by finite groups, and would be easy to construct an example from that.
This is one way of constructing the whole structure. To do something else, like relational space structure or something like that, does that help to avoid the construction?
I'm not sure I understood your question. I didn't mention it at all, but I'm working in triangulated categories and the derived, you know, bounded complexes, derived groups of bounded complexes.
Space structure works in that related, but I think it's like under
I'm sorry, can you take your math?
Like use a perverse linear filtration.
Yes.
Valence and space structure uses stratification.
I don't think I'm aware of this. Maybe you can tell me. Okay. Yeah. I don't know this.
Questions? Thank you, speaker, again.